Good morning, and welcome to the combined service of Willow Grove United Church and East Coral Maxwell United Church. I am Judy Sears. I am a licensed lay worship leader, and I will be leading you in worship this morning. I'm joined by Michael Connell, the music director at Willow Grove United Church. I remind you that our recorded services are being broadcast through YouTube. Please use the words Willow Grove United Church in the search box to find them. The services are also being posted on some Facebook pages. Please feel free to share these services with everyone around you. We light the Christ candle to symbolically remind us that Christ is in our midst. Let us cry out with one heart and voice, Jesus Christ is the light of the world. May Christ's light shine in you and in me each and every day. Amen. Jesus calls to us and beckons us to come. So from all walks of life, we come. We come to be renewed and restored. We come to bask in God's love. We come to be wrapped in God's compassion. We come to be embraced in God's beauty and holiness. We come because we are part of God's church. Through God's restorative power, come, let us worship together. Let us begin now to come to God in prayer. Good morning, God. Out of necessity, we are congregating virtually to worship you. As we sit in front of our computers, we pray that you will bind us together as a family in Christ. Help us feel connected to you and each other until we can enjoy the physical experience of worshiping you in our church building. Touch us now with your spirit. Envelop us with your love and peace. Be with us now and always. Amen. Our first hymn selection this morning is hymn number 651, Guide Me, O Thou Great Jehovah.
Thank you.
Children's time again, or time for food for thought. Knock, knock. Who's there? Moses. Moses who? He mows his grass twice a week. A long time ago, in a faraway land, there once was a baby named Moses. Legend has it that Moses was a strikingly beautiful baby. In fact, so very beautiful that light shone from his face, so that his face lit up the room. The legend also says that he walked and talked when he was just a day old. Not like any baby I ever knew. The baby Moses was born in a country where the ruthless leader, Pharaoh, permitted people who were Hebrew to be slaves. The Hebrew people, even though they lived in slavery, grew in number, so many that the Hebrew slave people outnumbered Pharaoh's people. So Pharaoh ordered that all Hebrew babies, boy babies, were to be thrown into the Nile River, because he was afraid that if all the Hebrew boy babies grew up, they would form a great army and overthrow him. Like all babies, Moses grew and gained weight and got bigger and bigger until Moses' mother realized she couldn't hide him anymore. If Pharaoh found out about Moses, he would send soldiers to take him and throw him in the Nile River. Moses' mother didn't want that to happen, so she made a basket out of reeds, which she covered with tar and pitch, sticky waterproof stuff, so that the basket would float. Moses in his basket went floating down the Nile River with his sister watching from the shore. The daughter of Pharaoh found Moses in his basket and decided she would raise him as her own son. Moses' sister, who had followed along, told Pharaoh's daughter that she would get a Hebrew woman to help raise Moses. And it turned out that his sister suggested to Pharaoh's daughter that Moses' actual mother should take Moses and look after him. Moses grew up with his own family until one day he went to live with his adoptive mother, Pharaoh's daughter. Moses grew into a great prophet. He became the connection between God and the Hebrew people. He led all those Hebrew people away from Pharaoh. When Pharaoh changed his mind and decided that the Hebrews could not leave, Pharaoh chased them. And that is when Moses, with God's power, parted the Red Sea so that the Hebrews could cross. The Red Sea closed and Pharaoh's army was swallowed up by the water. God called Moses up to the top of a mountain and gave Moses the tablets containing the Ten Commandments. It is believed by Bible scholars that the first five books of the Bible were written or dictated by Moses. Moses' mother hid Moses because she believed God had a plan for him. Moses' mother made the basket and put Moses in the Nile River because she believed God had a plan for him. Moses' mother believed that God would look after Moses. And God did look after Moses. Knock, knock. Who's there? Let us who? Let us pray. Hi, God. We pray that you will help us believe in you, just like Moses' mother believed. We pray that we will grow up in your care and that you will always look after us, just like you looked after Moses. We know that you have a plan for us, and we pray that someday we may be able to do great things, just like Moses. We pray that we will always do what you want us to do. Amen. Proverbs 25 says, a generous person will be enriched. 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 7 says, each of you must give as you have made up your mind, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. For all that God has given to us, we are truly thankful, and with glad hearts we give offerings which we dedicate to God for building up and fortifying God's church. Let us pray. Gracious God, for all that we have, for all that we are, for all that we will be, we thank you and humbly offer gifts to glorify your name. With cheerful hearts, we gladly give back to you a portion of that which you have freely bestowed upon us. With you as our cornerstone, enable our hearts and hands to do your work in our church home, the community around us, and the world at large. Amen. Our scripture reading today is found in the book of Matthew, chapter 16, verses 13 to 20. Now when Jesus came into the district of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, "Who do people say that the Son of Man is?" And they said, "Some say John the Baptist, others Elijah, and still others Jeremiah, or one of the prophets." He said to them, "But who do you say that I am?" Simon Peter answered, "You are the Messiah, the Christ, the Son of the living God." And Jesus answered him, "Blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father in heaven. And I tell you, you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades will not prevail against it. I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven, and whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven." Then he sternly ordered the disciples not to tell anyone that he was the Messiah. We give thanks for the word of God. May the Holy Spirit move us to an understanding of these holy words and guide us to live lives which have Jesus Christ as their foundation. Amen. Our next hymn this morning is hymn number 331, "The Church's One Foundation."
Thank you.
Jesus Christ, our Rock and our Redeemer. Be with us now as we listen for your word. Glorious God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be acceptable to you. Amen. In the time of Jesus, Caesarea Philippi, the backdrop of our reading today, was an area predominantly inhabited by Gentiles. Throughout the years before Jesus' visit, a great many temples had been built in the area. There were temples, 14 give or take, for the worship of Baal and all the mythical beliefs that surrounded Baal. Baal was a god of fertility, fertility of the land and fertility of the people. This was also the place where the inhabitants worshipped Pan, the god of nature. It is said that the cavern in this area was the birthplace and home of Pan. This cavern was believed to be the gateway to the underworld and the entrance through which Pan came and went when visiting and wreaking havoc upon the earth. Since the people in the area identified intensely with Pan, they called the place Panias in honor of that god. Immediately in front of Pan's cavern, there was a temple of white marble, which had been erected by Herod the Great to honor the godhead of Caesar. Herod the Great's son, Philip, later refurbished the marble temple and changed the name of the area to Caesarea Philippi. There was anything and everything in the way of religion except for Jewish religion. Yet it was a place where Jesus could not be spied upon, hounded, ridiculed, and judged by the Jewish leaders. It was a place where Jesus could preach to his 12 loyal disciples in relatively peaceful surroundings. For a short while, it was a place where Jesus would not have to fret about his coming demise. And it was against this backdrop of ancient religion and pagan gods that Jesus chose to ensure that his beloved followers knew the truth about who he truly was. In his commentary on these verses, William Barclay says, "There are few scenes where Jesus' consciousness of his own divinity shines out with more dazzling light." People tend to talk about notable people. Any person who stands out, any person who is different, any person who is important, any person who is influential is going to be a topic of conversation. Being just such a person, Jesus was a hot topic of conversation, particularly amongst the Jewish leaders. As we all know, information often becomes distorted when bantered about, and that is when rumors begin to spread. Rumor had it that Jesus was the reincarnation of one of Elijah, Jeremiah, John the Baptist, or some other great prophet. The book of Luke tells us that Herod found those rumors confusing because, although they did not believe, they believed that Elijah would return, at this point in time, they didn't believe yet in reincarnation. These rumors were not exactly an insult, but an indication that some people thought that Jesus was worthy of attention because he was a great prophet on par with, or perhaps even greater than, all the great prophets who had come before. Although these rumors were placing Jesus in high esteem, these rumors also meant that no one was openly proclaiming him to be the Messiah. Against the pagan backdrop, perhaps to illustrate what vast difference between pagan gods and the one true God, Jesus asked his disciples, "And how about you? Who do you say that I am?" It was crunch time. If his faithful followers had not figured it out by now, what would happen to his ministry. If even one of his followers believed, sufficient enough to proclaim his true identity, his ministry would continue. When you think of Jesus' question in those terms, you can almost hear the sigh of relief when Peter answers, "You're the Christ, the Messiah, the Son of the living God." There are, of course, different schools of thought on Peter's response. Some scholars contend that Peter's response enlightened the rest of the disciples, while other scholars assert that Peter put forth the statement on behalf of all of the disciples. These types of different contentions raise the question about who or what Jesus was referring to when he said, "And on this rock I will build my church." Some explanations are the rock is Jesus himself, or the rock is the truth which Peter revealed, or the rock is Peter's faith, or the rock is Peter as the first stone of the Church of God. William Barclay writes, "This passage is one of the storm centers of New Testament interpretation." Regardless of interpretation, the truth had been spoken clearly, plainly, distinctly. Peter, seemingly without hesitation, proclaimed it out loud in the presence of Jesus and the others. There was no taking it back once the words flowed off his tongue. "You're the Christ, the Messiah, the Son of the living God." Here is a synopsis, or synopsis if you are a Corn of Gas fan, of what Christians believe about Jesus based on a 2015 survey conducted by Barna Group. The survey was conducted among Americans. 92% of Americans, presumably not just Christians, believed that Jesus was an actual person on earth. However, the percentage goes down when considering just the responses of millennials. That is the good news. Even though an overwhelming percentage of those surveyed believed Jesus was an actual human being, only a meager 56% believed that he was God. 25% thought him to be a prophet, and 17% were undecided. On the question of whether or not Jesus sinned during his lifetime on earth, a whopping 52% indicated that he probably sinned, just like every other human being. With regard to making a commitment to Jesus, this part astounded me, so I'm going to read it verbatim, even though it is a little long. Quote, "While the majority of Americans report such a commitment, some groups are significantly more likely to have done so than others. Women, for example, are more likely than men to have made a personal commitment to Jesus, 68% compared to 56% respectively. White Americans are the least likely ethnic group to have committed to Jesus. Only 6 in 10 white Americans report having done so, roughly 60%, compared to 8 in 10 black Americans, roughly 80%, and nearly two-thirds of all non-white Americans, 65%. The more money people make, the less likely they are to have committed to Jesus. Those making more than $100,000 per year are significantly less likely, 53%, to have made such a commitment than those making between $50,000 and $100,000. 63%, or those making less than $50,000, 65%. And of course, millennials are much less likely than any other group to have made a personal commitment to Jesus that is still important in their life today. Fewer than half of millennials say They have made such a commitment, 46%, compared to 6 in 10 Gen Xers, 59%, 2/3 of boomers, 65%, and 7 in 10 elders, 71%. End quote. Sorry for all the statistics. Barna Group, while stating that the 150 million Americans who made a commitment to Jesus was an impressive number, they went on to say, as much of our previous research shows, Americans' dedication to Jesus is, in most cases, a mile wide and an inch deep. Not surprisingly, a 2018 survey conducted in Canada by Pew Research indicates that only 55% of adult Canadians identify as being Christian, and 64% of Canadians feel that religion is waning and has become less influential in the last 20 years. Those are dismal statistics, in my humble opinion. Is God's church crumbling? If only 50 to 60% of a physical building was left standing, the owner would probably be subject to a demolition order by the local government. All of that is very sad, but still sadder is that some of those statistics are instigated and perpetuated within our own churches. I remember a discussion with a colleague of mine about a sermon wherein the minister indirectly implied Jesus had never actually been alive on earth. I have heard a person in a ministerial position say that they don't really believe in the crucifixion and resurrection. And of course, the United Church of Canada employs an atheist minister. We should enjoy the liberalness of the United Church of Canada, the inclusivity, the creativeness, the diversity, all of that. But we should be true to what we profess we believe. Jesus, the Word made flesh. Many, many years ago, Peter was the first person to proclaim, "You're the Christ, the Messiah, the Son of the living God." Peter acknowledged out loud that Christ was the foundation of the Church of God, and Peter became the first rock laid upon that foundation. We are called to be the church. We are to be the rocks that build up God's church. When we proclaim, "You're the Christ, the Messiah, the Son of the living God," we become those rocks. That's a personal commitment to Jesus, and one only you can make. Based on our commitment, God accepts us and provides to us all the blessings which are offered to all members of God's church. During Christ's ministry on earth, he collected rocks from all over. Jesus continues to collect rocks still today, meticulously building up God's church. We must continue with Christ's ministry. Let's not allow God's church to crumble. As followers of Christ, we must believe sufficiently enough to proclaim his true identity so that his ministry will continue. I pose this. Who is Christ to you? Amen. What a friend we have in Jesus, all our sins and griefs to bear. What a privilege to carry everything to God in prayer. Let us pray. Gracious God, maker of heaven and earth, we are indeed privileged to be able to bring our pleas and concerns to you. Forgive us when we fall into complacency, when we suffer self-doubt, when we ignore your presence, when we fail to commune with you. We are but mere mortals who flit from one situation to the next without much thought, all too often thinking only of ourselves. Forgive us for our weaknesses. Help us change our ways and habits to better emulate Christ's example. Source of life, we pray for your hurting and suffering world. The pandemic is a heavy burden. Millions of people are sick. So many people have died. Many more will be afflicted. We pray for your intercession for all those who are suffering physically, mentally, emotionally. We pray they will receive your healing power. Keep us mindful that while we have been relatively protected in our immediate area, the pandemic is truly all around us. Help us follow the proper protocols stipulated by the medical experts that lower the spread. Relieve our anxiety and diminish our fears. We pray that the Holy Spirit may comfort and console all those who are suffering from grief or sickness, all those who are struggling with monetary difficulties, all those who are jobless, all those who are homeless. Be with them through their difficult times. You give us comfort, love, and peace. You give us life. All good things come from you. With happy hearts, we give you thanks and praise for the glorious days of summer, for the warm sunshine, the soft breezes, the gentle rain, the ferocity of thunderstorms. In awe and amazement, we enjoy your creation. Thank you. We are your people, and we are grateful and proud to be built into the very edifice of your church. Guide us in our lives so that we do not weaken what you have built up. Keep us strong in our faith so that your church may never crumble. Together we stand in your holy name. In silence now, O God, we lift to you those private concerns and petitions that we are unable to voice aloud. As Jesus instructed us, we pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Our closing hymn today is found in Voices United at 120, O Jesus, I Have Promised.
Oh, Jesus, I have promised.
strive to be members of that church. From here, where we listen and learn, from here where we are comforted and loved, we go into the world where things are not always as God intends. Go out into that world today and continue to build Christ's church, stone by stone, pillar by pillar, person by person. And until we meet again, may God hold you in the hollow of his hand.